You know, going back to what Dave was saying about beats and the way these songs come to be, this next song we're going to do, it's called On the Serious Side, and it's a really bizarre funk beat, and that's an understatement also. And the way the song came about, though, we used to rent charter buses to go, if we were playing in California, you know, 2 hours, 3 hours, we'd all meet at the Keystone Berkeley in Berkeley, and we'd bring all our friends, and we'd be on this bus, and we'd party all the way there and do the gig and party all the way back. And I remember there was a phrase going around. They were going, you know, on the real side, you know, it's like this. And, you know, on the real side, you know, and then it started to change. It was like, on the serious side, though, you know, but on the serious side, blah, 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 you know. And I don't know what got into me, but it was after the gig, and I remember I was walking up and down the bus, and I was going, on the serious side, boom, boom, skidit, dooba dooba da boom, dooba dooba dooba, you know, and I kept singing it over, and then we got back, and I told Doc, we got to write a song around that, man, you know, and so we wrote these lyrics, we had this groove. Well, I take it to Dave. You know, I'm like, yeah, it's a funk groove, man, you know, on the serious side, boom, boom, you know, just that, you know. He comes back like the next day and he says, I have this beat. I go, yeah? And he goes, yeah, let me play it for you. I'm like, where's one? You know, it's right here, back boom, 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 you know. And I go, let's try it, you know. And that's how that song came about because, you know, I'd sing the bass line, ka-dit-doo-ga-doo-ga-da-boom, doo-ga-doo-ga-doo-ga-doo-ga. And he just figure out ways to, you know, make that little rhythmic fabric that works so well in Tower of Power. So this is a song called On the Serious Side. Go ahead. Skidit dooba dooba de bomb dooba 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 de bomb. Skidit dooba dooba de bomb dooba 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 de bomb. Doop doop de boom doop 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 doop. Dooba dooba de bomb. On the serious side. On the serious side. On the serious side. On the serious side. Unsilly side. Unsilly side. Unsilly side. Skidit dooba dooba de bom dooba 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 de bom. Skidit dooba dooba de bom dooba 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 de bom. Right, check, check.
All right, thank you very much. Let's get some more questions going. I noticed.
What possessed you guys to come to Memphis to do your album, Bump City?
Steve Cropper.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, we were big fans of the Stax Volt music for years before we ever came in 72. And it's kind of ironic, you know. We came here, he had just left Stax. He was actually in a legal battle with Jim Stewart. And he was over at Trans Am Studios. And we said, you know, where can we get some good barbecue? He goes, go to the Rib Shack and have steak and biscuits. And we used to go, and like tonight we're playing Graceland, you know. So we used to go get steak and biscuits at the Rib Shack. And then we'd go and we'd park right before the gate with the notes on it in front of Graceland. And we'd eat our steak and biscuits. And we'd go, wonder what he's doing in there, you know. But it was another interesting thing about that recording, too, was that my manager set it all up. You know, we're going there. We're being produced by Steve Cropper. Like, we're in heaven, you know. Then we get there, and Steve's there, and Ronnie Capone, his engineer, fabulous, you know. And we're getting set up. We're getting going. And somehow he discloses that, no, he's just going to help get us set up and get going. Ronnie's going to take care of it, you know. And I was like, what? You know, and I go to my manager. I go, you know, no offense to Ronnie Capone, but we came here for Steve Cropper to produce this record, you know. And but after we did, I forget what track we did, we started recording, and then Steve kind of went, yeah, no, I'm going to stick around, you know. And he did the whole record, but because he was in that legal battle, it says produced by Ronnie Capone, but really Steve Cropper produced it.
Well, thank you for coming to Memphis again.
My pleasure. We don't get here enough.
Last day of Passover, I put together a little package for you.
So I was telling David on the ride over here that a lot of times when I get called on, when I get hired to do horn clinics, trumpet and trombone clinics, and I'm working with high school and college students, they always ask me, like, what were some of the biggest lessons and things that I learned, you know, throughout my career, or people that I've studied with? And the first thing I always tell them was one of the greatest lessons I ever got in lead trumpet playing was for the first probably like month that I was with Tower of Power. Every day after sound check, David would pull me aside. And he would say, hey, check this out, because he's got the most, you know, amazing ears. He hears everything that goes on stage. He would pull me aside and go, check this out. Here's what I heard you do last night. And then he would say, okay, this section was just a little bit off. You and I weren't quite locked in. And what he would do is he would then sit down. Let's say it was like Soul Vaccination, right? He would sit down at the set and have me stand next to him. And he would play that section that I was a little bit off on, so I could get like a visual reference. And every single thing that David plays there on the set, we're doing on the horns, right? And so I was getting a visual reference, and then I would just start playing with him. And it was like, you know those magic eye books that you open up and it's all blurry and stuff, and then you cross your eyes just a little bit and it comes into focus? Well, it was like that, you know? It's like all of a sudden, the second it would lock in perfectly, it was just like, ah, you know, and I got it. And then I would get, so this happened for several weeks after I joined the band. David was so patient with me in doing this for me and hearing, and it really, really got me honed in. But here's the thing, that never would have happened if I hadn't had the music internalized, right? There's something that takes place when you have sheet music in front of you, no matter how many thousands of times you've played it, for me anyways. If I have music in front of me, it's not going to have, my ears don't open up that way. But it's because the music is memorized and it's internalized that I was able to get with David and we were able to make that happen. So when I go and I do these clinics with high school and college, if any of you are educators, try this. I guarantee you'll be amazed. What I'll do is I'll have the band director, I'll say, have your lead trumpet, lead trombone, lead alto player memorize the last 16 bars of this shout chorus. And then when I get in there, what I do is I have the lead trumpet, trombone, and alto player stand around the drum set, and I have them play it with the drum with the drummer until it's locked in, right? And then once it gets locked in, I send the lead players back into their sections, and it's a whole different band. You'd be amazed at just at how it gravitates to the rest of the section. So that was a huge lesson for me, and it's something that I've been able to kind of pass on to students as well. So thanks for reminding me about that, David.
Yeah, thank you for that lesson. To add to that, too, is in the beginning years when I would start to play, I was playing all these crazy beats. The first thing I did before I had the beats is I would take songs that were like 2 and 4, and I would turn them around backwards. I would play the snare in 1 and 3. I would just play the whole thing backwards because I wanted to see what it sounded like. And of course, it pissed everybody off. And so what happened is as I started doing that and doing the beats and all that other stuff, really crazy things and disguising the one, I just said, well, why doesn't everybody count? And of course, that went over really big, right? I said, why doesn't everybody count? So Mimi made everyone count and pay attention. As soon as he did that, there was no problem. We owned it. We owned the groove. And I think that's a really good lesson for any bands that want to play together is if you want to own your groove, everybody's got to be involved in it. It's not the drummer that's doing it. It's everyone. So there are times when, you know, I go off the rails. I'll, you know, skid on a turn or some stupid thing, you know. The band keeps going because we're trained. And so I think that's a really good lesson, you know, count. Make the groove your own. It's just not the drummer's responsibility. It's the band's responsibility. The way that we play is because the tightness of it is attributed to the fact that everyone is understanding how to groove. Everyone. You do that, problem solved.
Hi, everybody. I'm Doc, and I have some tips for youngsters. It's better to rush than to drag. It's better to play sharp than to play flat. And it's better to cut off too soon than too late. And for Barry players, don't let the low notes go flat. And for everybody, if you smoke, try to get away from it as soon as possible. And if you don't smoke or vape, don't start, particularly if you're a horn player. I quit smoking 30 years ago, and I'm still paying. So anyway, that's my advice to you.
I should also point out, Dave was kind of modest when he said he told us to count. He used to go, count, motherfucker. I can't tell you how many times we heard that, but I'll tell you something. Years later, we used to do these gigs for this guy, Scott Page, that played with Pink Floyd, and he'd bring in all these heavy hitters like Jim Keltner and Marco Mendoza on the bass, and you know, a lot of heavy hitters in the band, Steve Jones on guitar, and they wanted to learn Down to the Nightclub, you know, and Down to the Nightclub's kind of an intricate beat, and it's got that extra little snap in there. And man, they were struggling with it, you know. And no matter what they did, we kept on going, you know. And I remember Marco coming up to me after, he goes, man, he goes, no matter how we screw it up, you guys stay in there always. I go, yeah, that's because Dave kept going, come on.